So there's this story in the Bible. I've preached on it a couple times already. But as Mother's Day is approaching, there's a number of times when Jesus interacted with women in a special way and honored them. And so as we approach Mother's Day, we're going to look at some of the times when Jesus interacted with women, what he said to them, and what we can learn from them. So we're going to read from Luke chapter 7 today. Luke 7, starting at verse 36. Now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much, but he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." There's a lot going on in this passage. There's a lot that we could talk about. But when I was studying for the passage this time, I came across a new way of looking at it. There's a couple things that are going on here that I didn't realize before. Okay, so if you're invited to somebody's house and you go there, there's a few things that you kind of expect, right? There's kind of a certain protocol that you follow when you go to somebody's house, right? So let's say I invited you to my house. So you come and you knock on the door, ring the doorbell, and I open the door and say, "Hey, glad to see you. Come on in. Can I take your coat? Why don't we go sit down in the living room? Can I get you something to drink?" You know, there's some things that you kind of do, and not every one of them is expected all the time. But there's these little courtesies that you extend to show that you're welcome. But let's say I invited you to my house, and you rang the doorbell, knocked on the door, and let's say I opened the door, but didn't say hello. Let's say I didn't even really make eye contact with you. I just open the door and kind of walk in. So you're kind of awkward a little bit. You kind of walk in, kind of just expecting that. And I don't offer to take your coat, so you kind of just take it off yourself and kind of hang it on one of those hooks, and I don't invite you to sit down, so you kind of just stand there, and it's just kind of awkward. You feel a little unwelcome, don't you? So there's these courtesies that we kind of just go through, because this is how you show people that they're welcome and you're glad to have them. And if those are omitted, then you don't feel very welcome. It doesn't feel right, does it? So back then, if you went to somebody's house, it'd be a little different protocol. Common would be a kiss of greeting. They'd kiss you on the face or something. They still do this in certain European cultures. Sometimes you do kiss on one cheek or sometimes two. And you would have some water, like a pitcher and maybe a basin, so that you could wash your feet, because in that place, it's really dry, it's really dusty, and when you're walking around all day, your feet get really nasty. So it's just kind of a common courtesy that if you come to somebody's house, you give them some water so they can wash their feet. Makes them more comfortable. That's pretty basic. And if the person whose house you're going to is really nice, they might give you some oil so that you can put on your head, because there, the sun is pretty high in the sky. It's pretty hot. If you're outside all day, your scalp is going to get pretty dry. It's going to get pretty uncomfortable. So if you put a little olive oil on that makes it feel a little better. Okay, so Jesus goes into this guy's house. His name's Simon, right? And as a host, Simon omits all three of these courtesies. He doesn't do any of them. So just like if you came to my house and I didn't even really say hello, I just kind of left the door open for you, you don't feel very welcome. But it might even go a little farther than that, because back then, these courtesies were not just common, they were kind of expected. This was a ritual that you followed. And if you didn't do it, that was pretty deliberate. And there would have been a reason for it. So the fact that this host is not showing these courtesies to Jesus, that means something. This guy is trying to shame Jesus, trying to put him in his place. Jesus is being publicly shamed. And you can kind of see this a little bit in the way that he responds when this woman starts washing Jesus' feet. If this man were a prophet, he would know. So Jesus is kind of on trial here a little bit. We're going to have him come in. We're going to turn the heat on him a little bit, kind of put him in his place, and we'll see if he really is a prophet or not. And then obviously, when this woman starts touching his feet, obviously Jesus fails the test. Now, well, another thing that's different between there and here is that this is what you call an honor-shame culture. There, in Jesus' day and time, well, pretty much the whole Bible time, what you want most out of life is respect. You want people to respect you for who you are in your place in life, and not just you, but your whole family, because your identity and your family are pretty much the same thing. You want respect. And so to be shamed, that's like the worst thing. That's the worst. So this is going to be especially painful, Jesus being publicly shamed at a Pharisee's house. So in an honor-shame culture, you interact with the people who are on your same level. So there's these Pharisees here, these religious leaders. Jesus is a religious leader, so we're going to invite Jesus over here, because theoretically he's one of us. But once he gets here, we're going to make him not be one of us. He's going to be less than us. We're not going to treat him right, and we're going to see how he responds. We're going to publicly shame him and tell him and make a statement that he's less than us. That's what's going on here. Now, this is a public event. People have these dinners together, and it's kind of a public thing where there's going to be a discussion between some people who know what they're talking about. So other people can come in and kind of listen in, and so it's a little different that way. So here comes this woman. She knows that she can at least stay on the side and just listen to what's going on. So this woman comes, and from what we can tell about this woman, this sinful woman has already heard Jesus teach about forgiveness. He was probably teaching out during that day, maybe that week. So she had gone to hear what he had to say, and she heard him teach that God forgives sins. If you repent, God will forgive you. You don't have this black mark on your record forever. God will forgive you. And this was a life-giving teaching for her. And so she comes to this dinner party with her best perfume to honor Jesus. She wants to say thank you to him and show her appreciation because of this new teaching that she's heard about how God forgives sins. And I have a lot of them. And wow, I am so glad to hear this. I'm gonna honor him. She's already heard. So she comes with that expensive perfume. And you can tell that she's already been forgiven, because when Jesus says your sins are forgiven and your faith has saved you, he uses it in the past tense. It's already happened. So she's already forgiven, and she's delighted to be forgiven. It's kind of like it says in Psalm 32, blessed or happy is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not count against him. Blessed, happy. So she comes with her best perfume to show her gratitude, how happy she is. So she has this perfume or this ointment or this oil. And part of that protocol at the beginning there, if you go to somebody's house, one of the things that you do is oil on your head, right? This is probably going to, what she's probably going to do, Jesus is going to come in, and there's going to be, you know, the host is going to kiss him, and he's going to get some water for his feet so that he can wash that. And then when they do the oil thing, if they do that, she's probably thinking, I'm going to just kind of sneak in there, and instead of just the regular olive oil that they usually do, I'm going to give him the best stuff. I'm going to put this on his head so that he has the best and so that he knows how important he is and how valuable this teaching is that he has. Well, so she goes there, all excited to be able to anoint Jesus, and none of this protocol is followed. He's not given water for his feet. He's not greeted. And there's no oil for his head. And so Jesus just goes in and sits down. Well, back then they reclined at the table. So it looked something like this. You lay on your left side here, and there's this kind of low table in the middle. And then you eat with this hand, and you talk with everybody else this way. That's kind of how it would work. So Jesus goes in, and he's reclining at the table, and everybody's heads are kind of in the middle there, so she doesn't have access to his head. She'd have to, like, step over everybody in order to get to his head. So his head's inaccessible, but what she sees here, she knows what's going on. She lives here too. She knows what's happening here. Jesus is being humiliated. She knows what's happening. And that makes her really sad. Because here's this teacher who teaches with authority. And he gives you this wonderful news that God forgives sins. And look what they're doing to him. Her crying is probably because They're shaming, publicly shaming her Savior. I used to think that she was crying just because of her sins, or maybe just because she was happy, and maybe that's part of it, but when she goes in there with that expensive perfume to anoint Jesus, to show how appreciative she is, and then she sees him, instead of being honored, shamed, that hurts. Her Savior is being publicly humiliated by the people who should be honoring him. And that's sad. The one that she came to honor is being dishonored, and the one who took away her shame is being shamed. And so she starts crying, because this is sad. This is just awful. How could they do that to him? How could they do that? He deserves better, not worse. What are they doing? So she thinks to herself something like this: if they won't take care of him, then I will. If they're not going to do these common courtesies for him, then I'm going to do it. The host won't do it, then I'm going to do it. So she, in doing this here, she not only takes care of those concerns, those needs, but she also attempts to restore his honor. And because he's being shamed, by her stepping into doing this, Jesus is being raised back up. Well, in doing so, she kind of makes a scene. She kind of attracts a lot of attention. This is not the normal protocol when you have a dinner party. You know, first of all, the weeping, the bursting into tears and stuff, she wasn't wailing or anything, but she was crying, and it was noticeable. And if she was wetting his entire feet with her tears, she was probably crying for a decent amount of time. So she's crying, she's making a scene that way. And it says that she's touching him. She's touching his feet. Now, the feet are the least significant parts of the body, so she can, you know, kind of get away with that, but still, she's touching his feet. She's touching it a lot. And she's a woman with a reputation. So everybody who knows her and knows her reputation is going to think things about him. So she's crying and she's touching his feet and rubbing them, and it sounds, I mean, just by reading it closely, it kind of sounds like she's being pretty meticulous about all this, and it's taken some time. It's not just a quick thing. And she lets her hair down. She lets her hair down. That's something that women did not do back then. That was considered immodest, even. So here she is being all inappropriate with Jesus. And she's making this scene. But one other thing that this woman, what's going on with her, is that she knows who Jesus really is. She knows. By all of these actions, we can tell that she knows that he really is more than just some prophet, more than just some good teacher. She knows that he's something much more than that. And she might not have had, I don't think she had catechism yet, so she doesn't know about being the Son of God or anything. She knows that he's something big. If he's not God, he is at least God's representative to us. Because usually when you are grateful for forgiveness, back then what you would do is you would go and bring a sacrifice at the temple. And if you had something like expensive perfume to offer, you would either sell that and buy an animal to sacrifice, or you would bring that to the temple to offer your sacrifice. She's not going to the temple. She's going to Jesus himself to show her thanks. She knows who he is. And Jesus is there, and he's letting all this happen. Now, if he was just doing what everybody would expect him to do, he would be like, okay, I see that you're grateful that your sins are forgiven. That's really nice, but you know, done with the touching. We're okay. You know, why don't you go and do your sacrifice at the temple like normal? That's the way you say thank you to God, you know. Thanks, but no thanks, you know. But all this kissing of his feet and all of that touching and weeping over him, if he lets it happen. And so now, with all of this going on, her making the scene and Jesus letting this happen, now the host is shamed. So the host wants to put Jesus down, but Jesus is being elevated now, and now the host looks like an idiot. He's upstaged as a host because there's this woman who's not his host, and she's taking care of him better than the host is. Jesus is not just getting the normal treatment, he's getting special treatment. So she comes in there, she's restoring his honor, she's shaming inadvertently the host. So this host is not really happy. And I'm going to read again what he says here. This is verse 39. If this man were a prophet, if he really were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she's a sinner. Well, just those words there, that says a lot about who he is. His criticism of Jesus shows pride in his own righteousness. How could Jesus let that woman touch him like that? She's a sinner. Unlike me, she's a sinner. And Jesus is letting this happen. He must not be a prophet. Usually when, and this is true for all of us, when we criticize other people, it says more about us than it does about them. It says what's really in our heart. And that's what's going on here. This is what's in his heart. That's not necessarily what's really going on. He's misjudging the situation. Our every criticism actually comes from pride. If we have pride in something, something of ourselves or something that we own or something that we do, and we criticize other people for not doing it, that shows that we really have pride in what we do, what we have, who we are. So you can brag about all kinds of stuff, and you can criticize other people for all kinds of stuff too, whether that's the kind of car that you drive, or whether you're street smarts or book smarts or what you wear or anything. So if you have pride in your clothes, then you're going to put down others for poor clothing. If you have pride in your knowledge and what you know, you're going to put down others when they don't know something. If you have pride in your school, like I went to this amazing school called Calvin College, and there's this loser school called Hope College down the street, and Calvin is so much better, and Hope is, they're just a bunch of losers over there, right? That kind of stuff. You can do it with Michigan and Michigan State too, but you're going to put down other schools if you have pride in your school. You can do it with Zealand East or West or Hudsonville or Allendale, whatever. If you have pride in your own righteousness, like Pharisees, you're going to put down people who are sinners. Now, it's one thing to take important things seriously. It's not good to sin, right? But it's another thing to use these to gloat about yourself or to put other people down because of it. So it's great if you and I, we do the right things. And we're good people. We treat other people kindly. We do right by people. But as soon as we use that to leverage ourselves better than other people, it spoils the whole thing. Now we're not good people for the right reasons anymore. Now we're good people so that we can be better than other people. We're not doing it for God anymore. We're doing it for us. We're not doing it to elevate God. We're doing it to elevate us and give us glory. So it's great when we value things that are important. But as soon as we turn that into us being better than other people, it changes the whole thing. So this Pharisee here, he's a good guy. He does the right things. He follows the law. He knows God. He's taken catechism. He knows who God really is. But once he uses that to look down on other people, now he's done it all for the wrong reasons. It's nullified. It's gone. And now you've fallen into another sin, pride. It's a silent but deadly sin. Ironically, it's Simon's own goodness that obscures his view of Jesus. He's a good guy. He does the right things. And because of that, he can't see who Jesus is. He can't see Jesus. He can only see who he is. He's a good guy, and Jesus is being touched by a sinner. Jesus must be in league with this sinner because I'm a good guy. See how that works there? If this man were a prophet, in other words, this guy's not a prophet. Look what he's doing. He can't see who Jesus is. He can't even see him for a prophet, let alone Son of God. So Jesus responds to this guy. And he says, I love how he says this. Hey, Simon, I got something to tell you. In other words, I got something to say to you that you're not going to like. You ready for this? That was a kind of a code phrase back then for, I got something to say that you're not going to like. Well, and Jesus tells this parable. This is the way Jesus works, right? When Jesus would get asked a question, a lot of times his answer would be, well, let me tell you a story. That's the way Jesus liked to teach. But Jesus' response shows that he's even more than a prophet. Not only is he a prophet, he's more than that. So Simon, you think that I'm not a prophet? Well, let me show you otherwise. First of all, he does know that this woman is a sinner. Because with this parable, it shows he knows who she is and he knows who his host is. He knows him pretty well. But not only that, his response shows that he even knew what Simon was thinking. He knew what Simon's thoughts were. Now, you know, it's not that Jesus was a smart guy. He's more than a prophet. He's Son of God. He knows stuff that nobody else knows. So Jesus does say, let me tell you this story. There's this moneylender, and there were two people who owed this guy some money. One of them owed 500 denarii. That's, let's say, 500 days of work. Because one denarius, that was a day's wage. So you work all day for somebody, and they give you that. There was somebody who owed 500 denarii. And there was somebody who owed 50. Neither one of them had money to pay back. So this moneylender, he canceled both debts. Said, fine, I'm going to cancel those debts. Jesus' parable perfectly pairs this woman with Simon. This woman is a known sinner. She owes 500 denarii. Simon, he's a pretty good guy. He hasn't made a lot of missteps in his life. You know, he does the right thing. He follows the law. praise to God, fast twice a week, all that good stuff. But even the best of us, we're still sinners. So he still owes 50. Neither one of them can pay anything back. And so in this process now, in verses 44 through 47, Jesus honors her and dishonors his host. Again, this is an honor-shame culture. Everything is seen in terms of who has honor and who doesn't. Who has respect and who doesn't. So in this response that Jesus gives him, I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. So what he's basically saying is, you're a lousy host. You didn't do any of the normal things that hosts normally do. None of them. And she's done them all. You're a bad host, threefold. And she has been considerate, threefold. So this woman gets elevated, and the host gets shamed. It's amazing how around Jesus, good people are often upstaged by bad people. This is a kind of a recurring theme throughout the Gospels. But like, you know the story of Zacchaeus. He wasn't just a tax collector, he was a chief tax collector. And Jesus was looked down on before going to eat at his house. Well, Zacchaeus turned out to have more generosity and more gratitude for Jesus than anybody else. You know the story of the prodigal son, where here's the son who's done all the wrong things, and now this son, he's more grateful than the older son. There's that parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. That's just in Luke. This phrase is really striking to me. This is from Matthew 21. Jesus says to these Pharisees here, I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. John the Baptist, he came to show you the way of righteousness. You didn't believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes, they did. And even after you saw that, you still didn't repent and believe. It's funny how around Jesus, the bad people somehow often upstage the good people. So here's a lesson for us here. If our good works and being a good person, if that doesn't come from gratitude for grace shown to us, if those good works aren't from gratitude for grace, they will become points for pride. We need to make sure that we're good people for the right reasons. Because of God. Because of what He's already done for us. Not so that we can feel good about ourselves. Not so that we can earn anything. But because we're grateful. Because of grace. Otherwise, we're glorifying ourselves. We're Pharisees. It's great to be a good person. It's great to do the right thing. It's great to follow the law. It's great to know God. But if we're doing this for the wrong reasons, we're Pharisees. And it's gone. We might as well not have done any of it. Let's make sure that our good works come from gratitude for grace so they won't become points for our pride. Let's look at the screen here. This question and answer two here. So our only comfort in life and death is that we belong to Jesus Christ. What must you know to live and die in the joy of this comfort? Three things. First, how great my sin and misery are. Second, how I am set free from all my sins and misery. Third, how I am to thank God for such deliverance. We need to know and have all of these three things. We need to know that we are sinful. We cannot do it on our own. We are not deserving. But God is gracious. He saved us. We are forgiven. And our only response is to say thank you with our lives. That's it. By ourselves, we're not amounting to anything. So the antidote for self-righteous pride, so that we're not Pharisees, is to know how much you owe. So, a question for us. Are you a sinner saved by grace alone? Or are you a good Christian and godly in your own actions? Do you have a lot of good stuff that you can stand on by yourself? Or is all your good stuff in who Jesus is and what he's already done for you? Because that's grace. The truth is that all of us owe more than we can pay back. So whether we owe 50 or 500, we can't pay God back. We can't earn his salvation. We can't earn his love. We have to be forgiven. And that's the same if whether we owe 50 or 500. We all have been forgiven much. In reality, all of us have. So even if we really only owe 50, we've been forgiven much. That's still a lot. So this woman, she knew that she owed much. That was very well imprinted in her mind. I do not deserve to be forgiven. I am not a good person. And because she knew that so well, all she had was gratitude. There was no shadow of a doubt that she could not earn her salvation at all. And all she had was gratitude. She had much more gratitude to give than the Pharisee did. And she was more worried about the shame that Jesus was experiencing than the shame that she would experience by making a scene and by even being there. So a final thought. It's only when you are forgiven that you can serve Jesus without shame. So this woman makes a scene because of Jesus. She's worried about him being shamed. This bothers her because he's her Savior. And we live in a world that seeks to shame Jesus. And if we go around like self-righteous snobs who have earned our own salvation, we're not going to give Jesus any honor. But if we walk around seeking to honor Jesus because of gratitude for what he's already done for us, we will restore his honor. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Lord our God, you've sent us your Son, Jesus Christ, so that we would be forgiven, that we would have everlasting life with you, and that we would be saved by grace. What a miracle that is. Lord, as good as some of us are, none of us can pay you back. None of us can earn that salvation. We pray, Lord, that we would be more like that woman who knew her debt than that Pharisee who tried to shame him. And Lord, that we would take you to heart, and that grace would be impressed on each one of us. And we pray in the name of Jesus, amen.